One of San Francisco's original members of the Beat poetry movement, Lawrence Ferlinghetti has stirred poets and readers the world over with his collected works and dynamic spoken word performances. Today, Ferlinghetti appears at D.G. Wills Bookstore in La Jolla, California, to read from his newly published work, Americus.
Ladies and gentlemen, I guess we'll begin. First, I'd like to thank Jack Webb of San Diego State and the Union Tribune for Border Voices, for 12 years of Border Voices, and the wonderful event they put on last night at San Diego State University. I'd also like to thank Professor Dan McLeod, who's not here tonight, for bringing Gary Snyder to us in 1992. Gary gave us Allen Ginsberg's telephone number. Allen was here in 94. Michael McClure came down, and now the spiritual circle is complete with Lawrence Ferlinghetti. Let me just read you some nuts and bolts that you all know about him, but let me just remind those who don't that he was born in Yonkers. He received a degree in journalism from the University of North Carolina, an MA at Columbia University, where he wrote a thesis on the influence of John Ruskin on Turner. He served in the U.S. Navy on several sub-chasers, worked in the mailroom at Time Magazine. I should also mention that while he was in the Navy, he was involved in the landing at Normandy on D-Day, and he served in Japan as well. He met George Whitman of Shakespeare and Company. By the way, Lawrence, I have a photo of George Whitman behind you here. There's a photograph of George Whitman and Lawrence at Shakespeare and Company that was taken by Professor Mary Duncan. And it's up here because George Whitman was present in 1950 at the Sorbonne in Paris when Lawrence defended his doctorate there. And so I wanted to have some of George's molecules here as well. And since George spoke at the old store back in 1982, I think, or somewhere in there. After Lawrence came back to the States, he went to San Francisco and with Peter D. Martin founded the first all-paperback bookstore in the country, City Lights Books, to which any bookseller in the world and reader in the world has made a religious pilgrimage at one time or another. He also began the Pocket Poets series and City Lights Press. The Pocket Poets series includes work by William Carlos Williams, Allen Ginsberg, Kenneth Patchen, Kenneth Rexroth, Antonin Artaud, and many others. Lawrence Ferlinghetti's second book of poems, A Coney Island of the Mind, is one of the best-selling poetry books of our time. He was named the first Poet Laureate of San Francisco. He's received a number of awards that I won't bother to read. The city, because it will be encyclopedic. City Lights Bookstore, of course, has served for half a century as a mecca for writers, artists, and intellectuals from around the world. Lawrence's publication of Allen Ginsberg's Howl in 1956 led to his arrest on obscenity charges, and the trial that followed drew national attention to the San Francisco Renaissance and Beat Movement writers. This landmark First Amendment case established a legal precedent for the publication of controversial work with redeeming social importance. Ladies and gentlemen, we are honored to have the conscience of America in my mind, Lawrence Ferlinghetti.
Oh, I couldn't possibly live up to such an introduction. I must have been talking about my older brother or something. Dennis, it's interesting that you should talk about the conscience of America, because that's what this book is trying to do. And I just happened to pick up a class a classic in your back room.
Happy to give it to you.
That'll be
your honorarium.
I'll be glad to rip it off. But anyway, this is a portrait of the artist's young man, James Joyce's great book. And the last page, I often reread this last page, and it happens to fit in very well with my intentions for Americus, which this is really not a full poetry reading. This is a reading from the new book, Americus. Yes. But I'm going to read a few passages from it. But I like to read this last part of the last page of Joyce's Portrait of the Artist. The last two paragraphs, the spell of arms and voices, the white arms of Rhodes, their promise of close embraces, and the black arms of tall ships that stand against the moon, their tale of distant nations. They are held out to say, we are alone, come. And the voices say, with them, we are your kinsmen. And the air is thick with their company as they call to me, their kinsmen, making ready to go, shaking the wings of their exultant and terrible youth. Mother is putting my new second-hand clothes in order. She prays now, she says, that I may learn in my own life and away from home and friends what the earth is, what the heart is, and what it feels. Amen. So be it. Welcome, O life. I go to encounter, for the millionth time, the reality of experience, and to forge in the smithy of my soul the uncreated conscience of my race. This is a... If any of you here haven't read the book, you really should. And Americus, I had in mind, was trying to, as Pound and Eliot said, to gather from the air a live tradition. In this case, to gather from the air of all that ever had been said or sung or written about what makes or has made the American consciousness. And in other words, to create the uncreated conscience of America. And so this book is full of thefts. I mean, all writers steal, and I read to steal. But there's been so much in papers about plagiarism lately, or a couple of years ago, that I actually have several pages of footnotes where I try and credit every theft, but I miss a lot.